Well, the Bible tells us about a man who ruled Babylon and all its land. Found the city, he built the wall and declared that Babylon would never fall. He had concubines and wives, called his Babylon paradise. On his throne, he drank and ate, but Belshazzar, it was getting late. For he was leaving the balance and the morning. His kingdom was divided, it couldn't stand.
I want gold, I want silver, something glorious, something worthy of me.
Greetings, I'm Bezel, and this is the Bus Bar. What if you were made aware of the fact that you only had hours to live? How would you spend those hours? Well, that's what was happening to Belshazzar, who was holding down the fort for his father, Nabonidus, king of Babylon, around 559 BC. While his dad was out leading the troops, trying to fight off the Medes and the Persians, well, Belshazzar, his party boy, was kicking it in the palace with his wives, concubines, and friends. And in Daniel chapter 5, we find Belshazzar holding a religious feast, most likely in honor of the pagan moon god Sin. And we're told there were 1,000 of his buddies there, and he was drinking wine before them. Now, years earlier, Nebuchadnezzar, the great Babylon king, who was Belshazzar's granddad, had invaded Judah when the evil king Jehoiakim was 25 years old and carried away the sacred temple vessels and placed them in the palace in Babylon. Now, as Belshazzar was toasting to any and all pagan gods there were, he thought it was a bright idea to bring in the gold and silver goblets and utensils that Nebuchadnezzar, his forefather, had taken from the temple in Jerusalem. These vessels basically were very special, were set apart, sanctified is the word, and they were used for a very particular purpose, to catch the blood from the animals that were sacrificed for the sins of God's people.
All praise the God of gold!
Praise the God of gold!
And silver!
Praise the God of silver!
Now, as Belshazzar and his cronies drank from these sacred goblets praising false gods, something happened that made Belshazzar's face turn ashen gray. A hand begins to write on the wall and make an imprint in the plaster which read, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin.
It's a trick! What is it writing? Oh, God, save us!
And of course, he once again tries to gather his wizards and astrologers and magicians and ask them to interpret the meaning of these words. Well, they can't do it. But his mother, who's standing by, reminds him of the Israelite Daniel, who in the past was able to interpret the dreams of his forefather Nebuchadnezzar. And Daniel is found and is brought before Belshazzar, who says to him, if you're able to read the inscription and make its interpretation known to me, you'll be clothed with purple and wear a necklace of gold around your neck, and you'll have authority as the third ruler in the kingdom. Well, in the past, Daniel had already been a ruler in the kingdom. Well, he says to King Belshazzar, give your rewards to someone else, but this I do have to say to you. God gave sovereignty, power, majesty to Nebuchadnezzar, your forefather, but he became proud and arrogant, and so was brought down from his royal throne and became like that of a beast until he recognized that God is ruler over all mankind. But you, Belshazzar, have not humbled your heart, even though you knew all this. You have exalted yourself against the Lord God of heaven and have praised the gods of silver and gold, of bronze and iron, wood and stone, which do not see or hear or understand. Now Daniel goes on and gives the interpretation. He says this is what God has written by his own hand, Mene. God has numbered the days of your reign. See, nothing happens apart from God's decree. As it says in Acts 17, in him we live and move and have our very being. Tekel, it was both a coin and a weight. And Belshazzar, said Daniel, you have been weighed in the scales and found wanting. Why? Because Belshazzar's void of displaying anyone's glory but his own. In fact, he set himself up against the very Lord God of heaven. And parson, the word means divided. as the nation will be divided, so will the body and soul of Belshazzar be. And we are told at the end of Daniel chapter 5, that same night, Belshazzar, the Chaldean king, was slain. So Darius the Mede received the kingdom about the age of 62. Now, what can we learn from this story of Belshazzar? Well, a couple things come to mind. First, Belshazzar for us is kind of a type of an everyman unbeliever. The word of God comes to him, but he does not understand it. It may have startled him and even frightened him, but ultimately it was foolishness to him. His habitual arrogance and ungodliness, his spiritual confusion and dullness of heart made it impossible to see or understand the truth that was right before him. You know, 1 Corinthians 2:14 tells us, "The man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually discerned." Now, secondly, Daniel for us is a type of Christ who unlocks the door to God. Remember, Belshazzar's mother tells him, "There is a man in your kingdom. This man alone can do what no one else could, interpret the words of God written on a wall." And in the same way, Jesus, the Christ, is the only person who can, by the power of the Holy Spirit, bring an unbeliever to faith and repentance. You know, many people think that in the end, you know, when we die, our good deeds will be weighed against our bad deeds, and if the good just slightly outweighs the bad, we're going to be okay with God. But in reality, it is that any sin or rebellion against God is like a huge lead ingot being weighed against a feather. What we need is a perfect righteousness that only the perfect life of the God-man Jesus can supply. 1 Peter 3:18 tells us, "For Christ also died for sins once for all, the just for the unjust, so that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but being made alive in the Spirit." So if you're a Christian, I want you to keep these two things in mind. We're charged to witness to the truth of the gospel to any and all who will listen. Trust that God will use even your feeble efforts to share the gospel, and he'll use them as he desires. God saves through the word of the gospel, but only those whom God has chosen will the Spirit call within one's own heart and allow them, enable them to respond and trust in the truth of the gospel. Romans 11:22, "Behold then the kindness and severity of God. To those who fell, severity, but to you, God's kindness, if you continue in his kindness, otherwise you also will be cut off." Now, do not let that if there, the if, bother you. Don't let it bother you. Be assured that all whom the Father has chosen and the Son has died for and the Spirit called will continue, bumpy as the road may be, to the end. Always hang on to the promises of God, even when doubt creeps in. And if you're an unbeliever, not a Christian, I want you to think about what happened to Belshazzar. He only had hours to live, and he was given actually a chance to repent and to respond in faith when confronted with his sin and pride, arrogance, all those things. And yet he didn't. He continued to laugh it off. He ended up giving Daniel all these things anyways. Who knows if Daniel actually took them or not. But we know that he died in unbelief. And of course, if that happens to you, you will spend eternity separated from the grace and goodness of God. You'll experience God all right, but you'll experience him without a mediator. And that is a horrible, terrible prospect. Keep this in mind. Read Daniel chapter 5 once again, or read it for the first time if you never have. Keep your heart open and allow God's Spirit to come in and change the way you think about this world and about reality. God will save those who truly call on him.